Now we will begin with the first story. We will say that we have a small title for every story. This story is called A Cup of Tea. It's nice. It's a very common story. Many people might know it. And so, Nanin, the Japanese master of Zen, who lived during Meiji era, one day he accepted a university professor who wanted to learn about Zen. Nanin served tea. He filled in the cup of the visitor and then continued, dropping tea in the same cup. The professor was staring at the tea, dropping, and at some point he couldn't help but say, "It's full, it doesn't fill in anymore." "Like this cup," Nanin said, "it's also you, full of your opinion and theories. How can I show you Zen if you first don't empty the cup?" So this is an interesting story. It's a very famous story. Everyone who knows a little bit about Zen, it's very usual to say that the mind is like a cup, and the mind is full of theories, it's full of many things, full of thoughts, and full of many things that we don't want them to be there because they are useless, actually. So there is the intellectual knowledge and there is gnosis. So the difference is that intellectual knowledge is something that comes from university, like from school, going to school, and you have some kind of degrees, a master, a PhD, many things. But the difference with gnosis is that it's about the school of life. This is what gnosis is, the school of life and the university, we could say, of life. And many times we think we know things, we think we know ourselves, we think we know about what we see, what we feel, what we think we know other people. But is it true? Because many times we can see that we don't know other people. Many times people surprise us and we say, "Oh, I didn't expect this from him or her. And I didn't expect him to treat me like this." So, or many times we might respond to an action of someone else with a manner that we haven't ever think about. And we might find there something new and maybe we will say, "Sorry, this wasn't me." Then who was? We might, many times we don't know ourselves, most of the times basically, but the point is that we are full of theories and we don't know how to put all this into practice, because we think we know, but we actually we don't know. We might know about mathematics, about science, about astronomy, and many other sciences, about poems, but what do we know about ourselves? And what do we know about how we are as people, and how we can, what we are doing in the present moment? So if our mind is full, then we can't learn. And this applies also to gnosis, because if we think we have achieved something and we know, then obviously there is no more room in us to know. There is no more room in us to know ourselves, and there is no more room in us to find something new. So this is why maybe Socrates has said, "The only thing that I know is that I don't know." Because truly, if you think, if we think we know, then we know nothing, because at the time we think we have achieved everything, we have achieved the absolute knowledge, then at this time we stop learning. there's nothing new to learn, we close our minds, and there's no point to learn something new. So we just close our as people, and the new never arrives. Maybe some new thoughts, but not after not many different thoughts than the previous one. So this is why most people don't change, because in order to change you have to have an empty mind without theories, and not to be full, to be open to the new, to be open in to learn new things. If we think we know, then we don't know. It's that easy. So then the next story is it's called "You Cannot Steal the Moon." It's a quite interesting story, and it says Ryokan, a Zen master, lived a very simple life in a small hut in the foot of a mountain. One night, a thief got in the hut, but quickly understood that there was nothing to steal. Ryokan returned to his hut and found the thief inside. "You might have come from very far to visit me," he said to the thief, "and you must not return with empty hands. Please, take my clothes as a gift." The thief was looking astonished. He took the clothes, slipped out of the hut, and left. Ryokan sat down naked and staring at the moon. He said, "You poor, I wish I could give you this beautiful moon." So this is very nice story, because most Zen masters are detached from material things, and we can see this in many stories from them. So there are some things that are priceless, and these things can never be taken from us. There are no things that can be there are things that cannot be stolen from us, because everything that can be stolen is all the material things, and it's all those things that do not belong to us. So what does belong to us? It is a very strong part of us, and it's the possibilities of our being, the possibilities of our innermost, the everyday miracles. It's like Ryokan, the Zen master, said that "I cannot give you this beautiful moon," because he values things differently than the other, than a common person who wants material things, who wants money, who wants positions, who wants clothes, many things. That's why he said, "I cannot give you this beautiful moon," because there are values inside of him that cannot be shared, but can be taught. We can learn, and we can develop some possibilities of our essence, of our innermost, and then we value things differently. We know which part of this life is permanent and which is not. And we can see that there is a lot of detachment from material things, from material life, because if you think about it, if we think about it, there are things that we cannot take with us when we die. We come with nothing and we live with nothing. So the most important thing in our lives is to develop our essence, to develop a very strong relationship with our innermost, with our being. And these facts and these aspects of our life, of our lives, makes us very to be detached from material things. Thank you.